I am the very model of a modern major general. I've information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and the coast of Fichus Tartical, from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations, both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I am teeming with a lot of news. With many joyful facts about the square and the hypotenuse. I am very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings animalculous. In short, in method vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
Hello, I'm Evan Handler, and I'm delighted to join in the celebration of Chartwell Booksellers' 40th anniversary. Chartwell and I have been friends to each other for as far back as I can remember. Not only do I consider it a tremendous historical resource, but an oasis when needing respite from any challenging day in Midtown Manhattan. I encourage everyone to stop by if you can. Paul Johnson was an eminent English journalist and historian. He started out writing as a liberal in the 1950s, but by the Thatcher era had become one of the Prime Minister's staunchest supporters and, in fact, speechwriters. His books, including A History of the American Peoples and Modern Times, are still widely read. His columns in The Spectator from 1981 to 2009 were then widely read as well and argued over. In 2009, Paul Johnson also published one of the best brief biographies of Winston Churchill ever written. It is interesting that in this book's relatively brief 168 pages, he chooses to address head-on one of Winston Churchill's most controversial characteristics, his imperialism. I would venture to guess that not everyone would assess Churchill's actions and views on imperialism in precisely the terms Johnson does, but here are his passages on the topic from the book Churchill by Paul Johnson. Of all the towering figures in the 20th century, both good and evil, Winston Churchill was the most valuable to humanity and also the most likable. It is a joy to write his life and to read about it. None holds more lessons, especially for youth, how to use a difficult childhood, how to seize eagerly on all opportunities, physical, moral, and intellectual, how to dare greatly, to reinforce success, and to put inevitable failures behind you, and how, while pursuing vaulting ambition and energy with relish, to cultivate also friendship, generosity, compassion, and decency. No man did more to preserve freedom and democracy and the values we hold dear in the West. None provided more public entertainment with his dramatic ups and downs, his noble oratory, his powerful writings and sayings, his flashes of rage, and his sunbeams of wit. He took a prominent place on the public stage of his country and the world for over 60 years, and it seemed empty with his departure. Nor has anyone since combined so felicitously such a powerful variety of roles. As a young politician, he found himself sitting at dinner next to Violet Asquith, daughter of the then Chancellor of the Exchequer. Responding to her question, he announced, "We are all worms, but I really think I am a glowworm." Churchill's experiences as a young warrior confirmed and intensified his imperialism. The empire was a splendid thing, enormous, world-embracing, seemingly all-powerful, certainly gorgeously colorful, exciting, offering dazzling opportunities for the progress and fulfillment of all races, provided the white elite who ran it kept their nerve and self-confidence. Churchill never lacked either and was anxious to display them in ruling an empire whose outward show stood for everything he loved and enjoyed. At the same time, Churchill had a warm and tender heart and a perceptive insight into the darker side of power. He saw the horror of empire as well as its splendor. He loved to be top dog, but he felt for the underdog. The River War, for instance, was an accurate and unflinching account of what he saw. He told his cousin, Ivor Guest, "I do not think the book will bring me many friends, but in writing the great thing is to be honest." It angered Kitchener and many others, another item in the growing dossier of Churchill's unreliability. The official reports after Omdurman said the wounded dervishes received every attention. In fact, he told his mother, their treatment was disgraceful and most were just slaughtered. Kitchener, he told her, was a vulgar common man without much of the non-brutal elements in his composition. This was toned down in the book. Even so, he dealt with the question of the wounded dervishes honestly, and he added, the stern and unpitying spirit of the commander was communicated to his troops. In a sense, he disapproved of the whole expedition insofar it was a gigantic reprisal for the murder of Gordon. He wrote, it may be that the gods forbade vengeance to man because they reserve for themselves so intoxicating a drink, but the cup should not be drained to the bottom. The dregs are often filthy tasting. It would be untrue to say that Churchill, as a young politician and junior minister at the Colonial Office, kept an eagle eye open for the blemishes of empire. But when they attracted his attention, he spoke out. He expressed his concern for the 600 Tibetans killed by the machine guns of the Young Husband expedition to Lhasa, and for the 25 Zulu rebels deported to St. Helena and who, he said, were starving there. He was quick to speak out for the Boers in giving a generous peace and reconciliation. In his maiden speech in the Commons, made immediately after taking the oath, his opening words were, if I were a Boer, I hope I should be fighting in the field. This was not the least courageous of the 500 major speeches he was to make in the Commons over the next 60 years. Nor did his eagerness to see war and the relish he took in it and in medal collecting blind him to its inescapable horror, or prevent him from taking every opportunity to warn fellow MPs about its nature. In another speech, in his first year in Parliament, he said that colonial wars were beastly, marked by atrocities and senseless slaughters, but a European war would be infinitely worse. He was alarmed, he said, by the composure, even glibness, with which MPs and worse, ministers talked of a possible European war. A European war cannot be anything but a cruel, heart-rending struggle, which, if we are to ever enjoy the bitter fruits of victory, must demand, perhaps for several years, the whole manhood of the nation, the entire suspension of peaceful industries, and the concentration to one end of every vital energy in the community. He added, democracy is more vindictive than cabinets. The wars of peoples will be more terrible than the wars of kings. These prophetic words were spoken more than a dozen years before the catastrophe occurred in 1914. Churchill was never a warmonger, as his enemies claimed. On the contrary, he warned against it just as urgently as he warned against unpreparedness for it. The two were indivisible. But Churchill was sufficient of a realist to grasp that wars will come, and that a victorious one, however dreadful, is preferable to a lost one. Happy anniversary, Chartwell Booksellers.